Why is High Court so reluctant to give relief to a man who may even make out a case beyond a very clear defenses, but makes out a reasonable sort of case? Why will that High Court not intervene? I think first and foremost, it's important to understand how the writ jurisprudence has developed over the last three centuries, shall I say, because we are a common law country. We were governed by the British for about 300 years. And in that rule, a lot of evolution of the judicial system took place, wherein we ended up adopting what the Brits were doing at their place in England. First, let's answer what kind of writ lies when a man seeks quashing of an FIR. Well, according to what I have learned over the last 17 years, it's the mandamus, writ of mandamus, which will lie. Because mandamus, if we dig in to the origins and genealogy of British jurisprudence, we learn that mandamus was issued because the courts came to the conclusion that the executive had exceeded its legal jurisdiction to do a certain act, or the executive, in this case, police and other agencies, they have deprived the man of his liberty or his life by bypassing the law. So under these two circumstances, a writ of mandamus used to be issued, that has traditionally been issued. It would also apply to civil sort of civil disputes also, where a man has been, say, his house has been taken possession of, he was on rent, without issuing a show cause notice, all those things. Writ of mandamus, why is the High Court reluctant to do? Now let's address that point straight away. For that, it's important to understand how writ jurisprudence developed in the last 200 million odd years. Well, if we go back to 1774, when India had become under British rule, that's the first time that a Supreme Court was constituted at Fort Williams, Calcutta. And by a royal charter, the power to issue writs were given to the judges who presided that court. Those powers constituted powers to issue five writs, which are now, you will find, mentioned in Article 226. Habeas corpus was the only writ of right. No other writ was a matter of right. Every other writ was classified as a prerogative writ of the king or the ruling monarch of England. It could have been a mandamus or certiorari or prohibition or quo warranto. So all the four writs other than habeas corpus were prerogative writs, were writs of discretion. That discretion rested in the hands of the king and the ruling monarch or the court which was presiding over, for instance, the Supreme Court, which was constituted at Calcutta. Now, over the next two centuries, we saw a lot of development in India as far as the judicial system taking shape is concerned. In 1798, Bombay High Court and Madras High Court came into being. Then in 1861, the High Court Act was passed by the British Parliament. All these three courts, Bombay, Madras, and Calcutta, became Presidency High Court. Important development of 1861 was also that Court of Criminal Procedure for the first time was applied to India, side by side. And these writs continued in action, that all through these developments, whether they were treated as Supreme Court or Recorder Courts or High Court, the writ jurisdiction continued. But the scope of that writ jurisdiction remained discretionary. Discretionary because, now why? Let's get into that. We've seen initially, before India adopted its constitution in 1950, even under the British system of administration of justice and governance, there were clean lines, clear demarcations of powers which the different heads of government were exercising. Now, everyone here present would know that there are three pillars of governance, of constitution. It's the executive, it's the parliament, and it's the judiciary. Now, parliament, of course, we're not getting to your question. Executive, of course, constitutes not just the minister, the union cabinet, but also its various officers. So a police officer or a CBI officer or an ED officer would fall into the category of executive. Now, that discipline which these legs of government have maintained is that there will be minimum interference in our respective functions. So the courts will be reluctant under the British system to intervene in what parliament is doing or what the executive is doing unless it is made out before the court that what those two legs of the government are doing are beyond the contours of law or fair play which the courts have established. For that, the courts are willing to give a lot of leeway to both executive and parliament in proving that what they did was within the contours of law and not beyond it. That's how the system has been. So this reluctance can be traced back to the doctrine of separation of powers. 1950 onwards, when our dominion status was given away and we became a republic and we had a written constitution in place, it became even more predominant. Now there were very well-defined executive, parliament, and judiciary. Their functions were very well-defined under the constitution. And there was this unwritten rule of not and minimum interference in each other's powers. We are confined here to criminal process. Even in that, the approach of the courts all through these years has been of minimum interference. And that's where you see the relation between reluctance to apply and invoke 226 to quash an FIR and applying the rarest of rare category principle. That we will not interfere unless you make out a case of outrageousness by the administration or the executive. So, and that's how Privy Council also sort of interpreted it. So the first case which one can dig out while discussing this issue is the case of Khwaja Nazir Ahmad, which the Privy Council, of course, the court sitting in England, passed in 1944. And in their words, they said that courts have no control in such cases as investigation or even the action of police in holding such investigation. Now, that was a very extreme position which the Privy Council took, bearing in mind their settled principles that even if something completely out of ordinary was shown, they will not intervene. Because here was a case where the petitioner sort of made out a case that please intervene, the court, the police is not acting within its jurisdiction. But I think there was some element of hypocrisy in applying the British jurisprudence of mandamus to English citizens and then to the natives of the colonies. Be that as it may, it changed. It changed when we had our constitution in 1951, our Supreme Court started functioning. And the first major decision in this direction which emerged was the decision of R.P. Kapoor. R.P. Kapoor versus state, that's the first decision which came. And that decision paved the way for courts to have some sort of clarity as to when and how and under what circumstances to exercise that discretion, and whether it's Article 226 or it's the Section 561 of the earlier Code of 1898 or the present 482 section, which now is tested to service whenever this issue of quashing comes up. Now, R.P. Kapoor also laid out certain guidelines. I will come to that those very, very quickly. But just to complete the flow of how the law moved, after the 1898 Code of the Criminal Procedure and 1952 Constitution, the Code of Criminal Procedure was overhauled. And in 1973, we had a new code, by and large, sort of carrying forward what was there in the last one, but making some certain amendments. But what was contained in Section 561 of the old code was carried forward in 482. Now, whether you talk about Article 226 and whether you talk about Section 482 of the code, the parameters of quashing remain the same. There is not much difference. The question is, when do you file Article 226 and when do you file Section 482 of the code? Now, as much as I have come to learn from by reading a whole lot of law on this point, you file an Article 226 when an FIR has been registered, but the investigation has not been completed. Investigation is not completed, so there is no inferior court at play. There is only executive, the police, the ED or the CBI investigating, and you want that proceeding to be quashed. So when there is no inferior court or its orders under question or under consideration, according to me, before charge sheet, one should file a writ. File a writ. Of course, if you come to a conclusion that the parameters of all those cases are being made out, and post charge sheet, if during when you buy, by the time you're deciding or you're filing, it's a charge sheet has been filed, and yet you want a quashing remedy of FIR and all the proceedings emanating thereunder. That's how you would appear, including a charge sheet. Then, according to me, once there is an inferior court at play, its order is also under consideration, its cognizance is under consideration, then you file a Section 482 Code of Criminal Procedure 1973 petition in the High Court.